ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
I'm glad you join us again, us DeSoto Brown and Martin Despang, on our relentless research, believing in the evolution of human-humane architecture here The Hawaiian Islands.
That's right.
And today we're going to stay on our island, which we mostly do, which is Oahu.
Yes.
And if we can get the first picture to give the folks who are not from here an idea about how Oahu looks like.
Well, the Hawaiian Island chain. Yeah, let's go to our map. There's our map.
And it's a little blurry, but I find it so cute. I find it so nice how the illustrator portrayed us, basically being stuck between these two mountain ranges. And what you see, there is a third mountain range that's basically architectural mountains, high-rises. And we just got down in our ranking. We have now, you were disappointed when I told you before the show, we're now on position six of having the most high-rises. We used to be four.
In the USA.
And one of the two cities that surpassed us is Houston. But Houston doesn't have to do that because it can sprawl. But we cannot go anywhere except we can actually go west. So that actually happened, unfortunately, since the 60s, 70s, where it became too expensive here in town. They developed west. And if you go the most west, because you can't actually, only you have an SUV, you can sort of in very slow kind of get around and end up at the actually northwest shore, right?
Correct. And so if we go all the way around the Waianae coast, if we go to the next photograph, we come to Makaha Valley. And Makaha Valley, interestingly enough, was used as the site of filming for this major motion picture, which was released in 1966, called Hawaii, based on a famous novel. Mm-hmm. And they used the Makaha Valley as one of the main settings for the film. Mm-hmm. And in the next picture, we can see that even though they built a lot of different structures to represent different time periods in the Hawaiian Islands, starting in 1820, much of Makaha Valley, which is what you see here, was still undeveloped at that time in the middle 1960s. And if you look in the bottom right, you see that there's supposed to be a heiau that's entirely artificial because they built this as a set. But nonetheless, most of, there weren't any modern buildings in there, but that was about to change very dramatically very soon after this film was shot.
And a European fellow is the bad guy, Max von Sydow.
Yes, he is, as they always are.
Exactly. And Germans loving, you know, the exotic.
Yes, they do.
The one sitting here included.
That's not excluding.
Let's we go to the next picture. This is also thanks again to my friend Stefan, who got me here the German version of basically season two, Hawaii 5.0. And we want to look at the last CD on the disc, which the German translation was The Queen of Polynesia.
Oh, okay. Maybe that's,
And that's probably even the
that's
original.
That's probably the original English title. Yeah, yeah.
And the whole basically episode is filmed at the project we're going to talk about
today. Correct.
And the next picture is one of the screenshots I took where they basically have this master plan, and you started to wonder, because you're actually also an eyewitness from the early stage.
Yes.
Share that.
Yes, and in the summer of 1969, the Makaha Inn, which is what we're talking about, opened in March of 1969, and I got to visit it in the summer of 1969, and then in the fall of that same year is when Hawaii 5.0 filmed there. Mm-hmm. I am not sure that the plan that we see here displayed on the chair actually is what was in existence at that time. I think this was a master plan that possibly never all, possibly not all of that stuff actually got built.
But let's look at the stuff that was built and that you have vividly in your memories. This is the next picture.
Right, and when I went out there to visit, we had lunch with my mother, my sister, I think my grandfather went, something like that. We had lunch next to this pool, and the main thing that I remember about the pool is the fountains that you can see in each of the four corners, which, as you were pointing out, are frankly artificial and man-made use of water for a water feature, which the pool was really the centerpiece of the buildings that were in existence at that time.
And we got a detailed shot, another scene where they were actually doing a close-up. Next picture, please. We were doing a close-up of the pool. And also reminded us of one of our first shows, which was about the Ala Moana Mall, where there was a similar water fountain feature that was very sort of rectilinearly architectural, very modern, international style.
Right.
However, you know, there was some references, some very modern artwork in there that wasn't nostalgic, that
correct.
Was basically interpretive of the culture.
Right.
So again, as we said, they were playing off the stark contrast of the very organic, as you said, very apparent mountain ranges on both
yeah.
sides, and then contrasting that with the artificial man-made.
Right. And those valley walls are very much a part of this whole experience when you go to Makaha Valley.
Yeah, absolutely. So next picture, I did three screenshots of, and you made me a compliment that I was capturing the main characters.
Right.
And this one character and his name is sort of interesting in a double way, right?
Absolutely. This man's character is Chin Ho Kelly. Chin Ho, the Chin Ho part was based on a real man whose name was Chin Ho, who was a developer. Chin Ho was the developer of the Ilikai Hotel and the Makaha Valley Inn. So it's appropriate that Chin Ho Kelly, the artificial character, mm-hmm. is in the building created by the real Chin Ho.
Yeah, and I want to point out that you see this sort of the modern ping pong, you know, table there. Of course, this is an object from the... from, you know, modern America at that time. But the architecture, as you start to see, is rather sort of subtle, is very sort of, it's wood's construction,
yep.
laminated construction, and it's a big overhead, so it's a shading device, right?
It sure
so
is.
Climatically, because this is a pretty hot valley, right?
It is a very hot and dry valley, and yes, you do want shade there.
So next one is our main character here, next picture.
Second, that's Dano.
Okay.
And as you pointed out, and this is very true, the setting for this scene is that a gigantic gem is being unveiled and shown to a bunch of people in a party, and of course it gets stolen.
Mm-hmm.
The 5-0 guys are there to guard the gemstone,
mm-hmm.
so they're dressed in party clothes, but they're always dressed up anyway.
Mm-hmm.
You never see them in
yeah.
any kind of casual
yeah.
clothes.
Yeah, yeah.
They're always dressed up. So
yeah.
that's Dano, who's McGarrett's right-hand man.
And then next picture, there is McGarrett here.
There he is.
Talking to some folks. And we see something introduced in the back, a theme that we dedicated a show to. We called it Fins and Slats, Slatted Hawaii. But we got to move on. We got so much stuff to cover.
Yeah, yeah.
So now we want to open your archive. So the next couple
yeah.
of pictures is your stuff from the archive.
Right. And so this is from my collection. And as you can see, this is from the very beginning when the entire resort first opened. And I want to point out that Chin Ho, his development company, Capital Investment, was talking about developing the valley as early as the late 1950s
mm-hmm.
to be, quote, the second Waikiki.
Mm-hmm.
So this was supposed to be the very beginning of a great deal of intensive development.
Yeah.
And although that says opening December 1968, that was the golf course that they're
mm-hmm.
talking about. The hotel
mm-hmm.
opened in 1969.
It wasn't almost, I mean, this the whole, like, the logo, the sort of
yeah.
the branding, almost has this, I subtitled this innocent. I find this approach like almost like, I mean, I avoid to say silly, it certainly wasn't, but it was innocent. It was like, okay, we do this, there's nothing wrong about it, we don't have a bad conscience.
Right.
So it was really innocent times, like shooting people to the moon at the same time.
Exactly.
Right? We haven't
exactly.
quite figured it out, but let's just do it, let's try.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly.
And
that's
so,
right.
Next picture is a more sort of historic, I guess the correct one from your archives as well, but you pointed also out that actually being so luxuriously generous with water is sort of against nature, as we pointed out.
Right.
It's very dry there. So
it is a very dry.
This is a big effort and actually pretty wasteful, as golf
yeah.
courses are in general, right?
Absolutely, right. It's like doing it in Las Vegas, almost.
Exactly. And so the next picture shows sort of more the inhabitation, which you already see in this previous one here, because part of that were these cottages. And the cottages were very lushly integrated in
right.
palms were not native there too, so they needed
no.
to be brought there and planted.
Exactly,
right?
And there was a whole bunch of large trees which were planted and irrigated to keep
mm-hmm.
this area shaded and to blend all those buildings
yeah.
in.
But a very sort of exotic, and you see how funny the guy, not only the actors in Hawaii 5-0, but also the visitors
diner.
Are
yeah.
in suit and tie there
right.
in this very lush tropical. Look at the blanket, the cool kind of pattern of the blanket.
Yeah, that's right.
Matching sort of the scenery, right?
Uh-huh.
And the next picture is showing similarly sort of the lifestyle, the portrait lifestyle. You told
correct.
Me this was right after the opening.
This is right, this is 1969, 1970, the dining room with a big
mm-hmm.
dramatic sculpture, the guest rooms, the various amenities. They wanted to claim that you could fly there from
uh-huh.
Honolulu rather
yeah.
than drive. So
yeah. And we get to the helicopter later.
We will
because,
get it. We will see a helicopter.
Hawaii 5-0 is celebrating that
right.
too. So then we were going online, we're doing research all over the place. So the next picture is something I just Googled. And there's very little left, but these are three pictures which are more or less basically portraying the same, which we've seen before, just a little bit more
details. Modern.
And then the best picture is the next picture that I found, because I've never seen this anywhere else. Also very good resolution. And I subtitled this basically hardscape, because, you know, in this lush natural valley, they were pouring concrete like crazy, like football fields, right? And then also these sort of planter boxes, architecturally very nice, sort of horizontal groove, so, you know, underlining the landscapey kind of notion. And just this tropic, this artificial tropical paradise that they created so, innocently or virginally, however you want to call that.
Yeah.
So this got us so excited. We did a little bit of research online. We couldn't make up our mind what was happening and what was still there. So we drove there. Next picture. Both great synchronization, synced as we are at the same time, but without letting each other know.
Correct.
So we must have just missed each other.
And we explored the whole valley separately.
But we both went there first. And also it has information at the bottom. When you Google for the architect, for the creator, there's two different architects. There's the golf course architect, and there was Mr. Bell, and Mr. Bell is credited for having been an expert. And the golf, and this is the only function that's still kept and maintained, is the golf course, and this is the clubhouse,
that's right?
That's right. And you went and looked, if you can get the next picture, try to see, is this actually an original building, right? And you did this comparison.
I think that the similarity between the clubhouse, which is up on the top, and one of the main buildings, the dining room of the original Makaha Valley Inn at the bottom of the picture, to me suggests that, that probably is an original structure from when the golf courses opened. And there were two original golf courses, which opened actually just before the hotel did.
And we were both a little disappointed, to be honest, and drove away. And then next picture, there was a sign of hope, literally and figuratively speaking.
Right next to the parking lot.
Next to the parking lot. And there is a sort of battered post out of lava rock. And then this iconic beam out of laminated timber.
Yeah.
So this is like, we call this a mock-up, you know, or this is like the essence, the soul of the building,
right,
which I always ask my emerging generation to do is I capture in a model the essence.
Right.
And this is the essence of the architecture, sort of the earthy walls, and then this lofty, airy sort of wood roof construction.
And horizontal and vertical, too.
And then, and I then asked, you know, the lady at the sales shop there where the resort is, and she said, it's pretty much gone, but you find leftovers if you drive down and take a left, and maybe she said right, I don't know, but I took a turn to the left in the next picture, and that was good, because all of a sudden I ended up at these walls. Once again, battered walls in a very sort of modern composition. So I thought this might have been the original gate to the whole area, which
you're
confirmed.
And you are correct, even though they're all overgrown now and there are no signs left on them. When this whole valley was being intended for development, this was to welcome you to this entire new modern development, started with the golf course and the hotel.
Okay. But then even more sort of characteristic and surprising is the next one on the other side, directly opposite of these walls, is this pool that has the same sort of finish as all the low walls, the planters on the area, which we just saw. But then sort of hidden now in these bushes is there comes this concrete mouth comes out of this concrete pool and is basically accentuated with these lava rock walls.
Yes.
So you see this sort of intentional contrasting which we talked, okay, there's nature and there is indigenous
and
there is sort of earthy and there is us progressive and concrete is all material of the time.
Yeah.
So one wasn't trying to make things look like they've always been there, which we try these days, which we get to at the end of the show,
right?
It was very proud of sort of mid-century pioneering effort and gesture.
Yes. Modernism.
Exactly. But then we kept on, I turned around because I sensed like, okay, this couldn't have been it. Where are all these buildings that we knew
hotel.
From the master plan? Exactly. So we drove the opposite direction again, and that's the next picture. and ended up at another gate or a sign.
Right. And much disfigured by spray paint.
Exactly. And then you have a funny story to tell about the bird that's missing.
Well, okay, on the sign, which is partly obscured, you can see there's the logo of a peacock, and that logo is in the upper right left corner. Mm-hmm. The resort presumably released peacocks in the early 1970s. They became a pest in the valley because of the amount of noise and how aggressive they were, and that is a typical example of a bad introduction. Yep. That's something we talk about all the time. And one woman who lived in one of the condos actually beat one of the birds to death in the parking lot in anger, for which she got arrested. There don't appear to be any peacocks left anymore, so assumedly somebody went through quietly and killed them all, because you don't see them there anymore. But they used it as a logo for the hotel.
So it's another example of this sort of artificial construct that they created.
Absolutely.
Not really thinking which kind of plants, not really thinking which kind of birds.
Right.
Just thinking of what would people imagine could be exotic, you know, but isn't really to the specific location. But the next picture, this is where it gets extremely exciting, because here we were archaeologists pretty much and found old foundations and situations. So one thing is pretty much, so we got that water feature at the lower gate, and we got that prime water feature at the central plaza, which I assume you came and drove around, as you can see, and people were dropped off.
Yes,
right?
That's exactly correct.
And you can still see the old pavement there, which is pretty much the same as on the sidewalks of Waikiki on Kalakaua.
Yes, it is. Yes.
And
kind of flagstone.
Exactly. So the next picture is, because that's pretty much it. We were looking for more, and everything else, as you pointed out before, this massive thing they tore down, and they must have bulldozed. Where did all the debris go? And there are these kind of funny ditches in there.
Yeah.
So why did they dig in so deep? And the picture at the top showed all these sort of artificial plants to that specific place. Palm trees are all dead, right?
Because they're not being watered anymore.
Exactly.
Right. So there are all these large trees which once were there irrigated as part of the grounds.
Exactly.
And they're either sickly or many of them are died because they're no longer being watered.
Exactly. Next picture shows some other leftovers. So I found this other picture at the bottom left, also online, where there must have been these sort of bowl sphere-like light fixtures. And you can see one, you know, sort of still there. So, and then also you see some kind of rubble, which you can see architectural, refinement on it. So once again, there are these, like in archaeology, where you dig for the old Egyptians or for the Aztecs, you find
ruins.
Things. But this is fairly recent history. So
the question is,
what went wrong? And you have some clues about that, right, too?
Well,
while you talk about it, maybe we get the next picture.
Yeah.
Because you always have provided a picture that turns out to be my favorite picture in the past shows. And this is my favorite picture from your archives that, for me, perfectly portrays that sort of composition of the mountains in the back. And last time we were talking about sort of the most beloved roof these days that developers think, you know, everyone thinks it's local, is the Dickey roof, which is a plantation roof. And this one here is more like a pagode-style roof, right?
Yes.
But you also said it wasn't unique for the island.
No, it wasn't, but it was something popular in modernism, this really large, dramatic, swooping curve.
Yeah.
You see it executed in wood, you see it executed in concrete, and you see it here. And you were saying, is that an architectural inspiration from the walls of the valley? And perhaps it is.
And let's see how the architect described that, because next picture we found on a website of architects this explaining, and I put this here in bold here, placed in a garden setting in a system of walkways and recreational areas. The hotel is intimately related to the contours of the site and so on and so on. And they say the colors and the materials are either indigenous or compatible to the region and add to the general atmosphere of informality and leisure. Mm-hmm. And I think this is you know, I honor them for them. I credit them for that.
Yes.
And I think that was their true intention.
Yes.
It wasn't to like dump something there, something invasive that you decorate to pretend it is fitting in.
Right.
But it was in their sort of very own way, maybe silly and certainly innocent way, honest, right?
Right.
And what also belongs to the development is what we've seen a couple times is also part of the middle between us and the permanent background is that little thing in the distance
there. Well, it's not that little when you get up close to it.
And so This is a residential, a condo development that was part,
yes.
And that got very sort of dramatically and sort of patriotically almost portrayed in the Hawaii 5-0. Next picture. Because here's our helicopter.
With Steve McGarrett.
With Steve McGarrett, and it has the signage of Makaha. And because of the resolution, because this is me taking pictures with my phone off my computer screen, playing the original quality show.
Right.
But there are construction cranes.
Yeah.
You can barely see. There's
yes.
a yellow one, and there's a blue one.
Well, and
you have the timeline going.
Right, and this was filmed in October or November of 1969, and just a short time afterwards, December of 1969, the condos topped off. So they were almost completed by the time this photo was taken that you took of the TV show when it was being filmed.
Mm-hmm. And then, did you drive up to the condos as well?
I did.
Okay,
I did.
So we drove up to the condos without knowing. We
Correct.
Were both. So next picture turns out to be my favorite picture, because we're going to make a show about that we call Tropical Ascending, which is about walking up here on the island.
That's right.
And of course, this leads to staircases. In best case, these are the ones that we want back and we didn't have for a while because of the invasive building code, the mm-hmm. IBC. But these ones are the true mid-century ones, easy breezy ones,
yep,
right?
Totally.
And they're sort of standing there as these heroic towers, or the ends of the towers, and basically aligning like guards, you know, mm-hmm. the natural mountains, which are mm-hmm. so close, which you also shared with me caused a problem.
Right. There was in probably the 1990s a substantial landslide that occurred off the cliffs next to one of the condos. Buried a lot of the parking lot next to that, in back of that condominium, and caused a lot of publicity at the time as to whether this was a dangerous situation for mm-hmm. people who live there, mm-hmm. etc. So they are up right up close to nature, mm-hmm. and that is something to consider.
Now, I don't know about you. They didn't let me. I wanted to walk around,
no.
and I ended up being at the gate, and she said, "Who are you visiting?" And I kind of stuttered stupidly, and she said, "Okay," then turn around, and I said, "Well, should I back up?" She said, "No, I let you in, but you drive around, and you'll be back soon." So all these pictures that you see next
you
one.
You got in. I didn't even try that.
I got in. So next image here is that. But this was me almost on the way out again, actually. You can actually see the nature. When they look very solid from the front, they look very skinny from the side, because there are linear skinny towers. The single-loaded corridor, the ones we love.
Yeah.
And there is a circulation facing the mountains, and then you got the view towards the valley. And
right.
then the next picture is showing the easy breezy circulation always, and it's a very sort of linear, very rational mid-century modernism that you know climatically makes a lot of sense. And you can see even the bars of the guardrails is sort of texture, right? We
mm-hmm.
had a show about architecture,
mm-hmm. and they also let air through.
Exactly. So they're actually pretty exotic, and although probably not conceived that way
Correct.
By many people, right?
But that's just the level of technology at that time.
Exactly.
They would not have built an entirely
exactly.
closed hermetic structure.
And now comes the low point, because when you exit it and drive down to the back to the beach, you see that one here.
Right.
And this is shocking. This is what we're afraid will happen maybe if they redevelop the valley, which you're talking about. This is just one of these generic gated communities, as you can tell, with this sort of buildings that are hermetic but are decorated with some porches, and they could be anywhere in Las Vegas, in LA,
yeah,
or
sure
somewhere.
Could.
So this is sad to see. And next picture, going down one more step, is our most activist reporter, Kurt Sandburn, who we briefed in our research. He said, "Oh, this coast is probably going to be Disney-ized,
right?"
Because Aulani is not far away, so I took a chance to refresh my memories from Aulani. So this is interesting, different to the honest, authentic
yes.
approach of easy breezy modern mid-century. This one here is the opposite. This is a generic, he called it a box, double-loaded corridor, that they then because the tourists, you know, have to like it as being something local,
mm-hmm.
they decorated. You like to call mm-hmm. it ornating here.
Yeah, it's ornamented, and it's got this sort of faux Polynesian exterior on it,
mm-hmm.
which mimics but does not have any function some of the original structures which were created in Polynesia.
Yeah, yeah.
And I want to point out at the bottom of the picture, in the center, is your hand knocking on what looks like a wooden post, but you said that that's entirely artificial.
That's fiberglass.
Right,
yeah,
and you can tell by hitting it with your thumb or your finger, yeah, your knuckles, yeah, and you know that it doesn't sound like wood.
This is corporate America theming locality here, pretty much. And next picture is, again, the contrast of the pools we already talked about, the mid-century pool and this pool here that pretends to be local, but never mind the little chlorine swimmer that
little
swims
dispenser,
there.
Right.
That tells it all that it's all artificial,
right? Right.
But we always close on a good note. So the next picture is the original part of Olani was called Ihilani and is now the Four Seasons, just remodeled. And it was so stunned to see what we always say we should do. We have a trough, we have plants growing out of the trough, and maybe we have a curtain to mitigate the wind, we have an overhang. So that is still existing there.
Yeah.
And that gets us to, we always conclude the show with a proposal. And our proposal today is the next picture. Is also informed by our former tropical tourism guest expert, Suzanne, who basically was telling me, Martin, you know, actually out west, she just read this article on the very top right that they're going to make this homeless camp at Nanakuli, and that's pretty close.
That's along the Waianae coast.
As well, it reminded us of the Coco Palm Resort that we did. That development isn't going so well.
No.
So our radical proposal this time is what, DeSoto?
Well, there's Primitiva. There's the Primitiva Tower, and if you look, it's not that easy to see, but now we're zooming in to see it. There it is, plunked down in Makaha Valley. And what does this do? It is, of course, a high rise, but it also is open, and it also contains a lot of greenery, and it also has a lot of other features that we've talked about before. So if the valley is not going to be developed, and if they are not going to renew or rebuild the resort hotel, then the Martin Despang concept is, why don't we put Primitiva there instead? And that not only is sort of a pleasant, ecologically pleasant place to live, but it also is where you can put homeless people.
And we go to the next slide. this portrays it again. This is the next and last slide.
Oh, glowing at night.
It would. There would be light in there. So at night, it would decamouflage itself and would reveal what you just perfectly described, this inclusive sort of, you know, inhabitation.
Correct.
Of all sorts of people.
Mm-hmm.
And we would kind of have what we formerly called, this is what Suzanne points out, there's a new tourism is coming along, which goes along with people who are interested not to deplete a place, but actually really experience and share things.
Correct.
And so people would be visitors and short-term inhabitants. And one would...
Right, and it wouldn't just be permanent residents, and it wouldn't be formerly homeless people. It's also a place for tourists, basically tourists.
Exactly.
So what you're saying is, let's mix those people together in an environment where everybody can intermingle, plus a number of different amenities are provided as well. Plus, you've got the famed Easy Breezy air circulation.
Which, I'm not mistaken, is a very Hawaiian attitude to be inclusive, right?
Yes,
and welcoming people of all kinds.
Yes, it is.
And so our really provocative proposition is, keep the valley what it was and now is again, is basically nature. And basically, because we're not against development and growth and all these things, we need that. But we say, you know, basically align the existing condos with Primitivas.
And there we are.
Which, due to their nature, would look less architectural, but more organic.
Right.
And
we're not advocating the demolition of things, because the demolition's already occurred.
But as Doko Momo board members, founding board members and supporters, we would say these two fountains, they're still there. Bring them back to life and keep them as monuments and as reminders. Of the good old
of this
times,
time period.
Right? Exactly.
It's part of the history.
So with that, thank you guys for your attention and for your interest. In 2 weeks, we're going to see each other again. We're going to go back to town, because in town is where we actually should develop.
Yeah.
But we keep our eyes open, and we're going to go on to another street that you have some very vivid childhood memories
from. Oh, we're going to go to Alawai Boulevard.
We do that.
Yeah.
And the show is going to be called the...
Oh, Beauty
exotic,
and the Beast.
The Exotic Beauty and the Invasive Beast.
That's
so
right.
Let yourself be surprised.
Yeah.
And until then, stay magically exotic. Bye-bye.